This is episode 72 of the Women in Depth podcast. The information found in this podcast is not a substitute for help from a licensed mental health professional. Hi, and welcome back to the podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Lourdes Fiotto. Today's episode was inspired by a listener who emailed me after she heard Dr. Marilyn Steele's episode number 39, Soul Song, Awakening the Wild Feminine. The listener wrote that although she felt very connected and comfortable with her feminine energy, she was asking for some insights on how to express her inner masculine strengths, and that the inability to do so was blocking her from moving forward in the way that she desired. This email really resonated with me because I felt that what this listener wrote, what she had the courage and the vulnerability to share, is something that most women, if not all, can relate to. So my dear friend and colleague, Dr. Marilyn Steele, and I decided to have a conversation about this very topic. Today, we'll be talking about what the inner masculine or masculine principle is, why women struggle with expressing their inner masculine, healthy and unhealthy expressions of the masculine principle, and tips on how a woman can begin to reconnect with and express this principle in her life. So thank you, dear listener, for inspiring this relevant and meaningful dialogue. Dr. Marilyn Steele is a Jungian psychologist, author, speaker, and spiritual mentor to adults at midlife. She works with writers, creatives, visionary entrepreneurs, transformational leaders, and women in life and career transitions who desire greater access to their feminine power, their wild soul desires, and a path to bring their wisdom into the world. Dr. Steele is also the author of The Wild Feminine, Stories to Inspire and Embolden, which is available on Amazon. Hi, Marilyn, and welcome back to the podcast.
Hi, Lourdes. It's wonderful to be with you.
Thank you so much for taking this time again. This is your second time on the podcast, and I wanted you to come back to talk more in depth, this time about the masculine principle, or you know, what we would also refer to as masculine energies. Mm-hmm. And this is because of a response I received actually from a listener. And this is what the listener wrote. She said, "Lourdes, I love this series of talks. Can you please do a talk with someone who can advise a woman how to channel their inner masculine strengths? I am intuitive, compassionate, and creative, and that comes easily. But I am not competitive or ambitious, and I know I'm holding myself back because I have no masculine energy to throw behind my more authentic feminine sides. I have good ideas and I have passions, but I have no confidence in my ability to become successful in those areas. I believe it's the masculine side of me that needs to be awakened. How do I do that? Mm-hmm. How do we throw masculine energy behind feminine plans?" Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what are your thoughts just initially hearing that question, Marilyn?
It's a wonderful question. And I love how she put it, throwing the masculine energy behind the feminine, you know, to take action. So it's a wonderful question and a very important one, I think, especially timely too, because we have in the culture at this time and the world, a lot of stories, a lot of surfacing of what a toxic masculinity is. So we want to talk today about what it is to be incorporating and enlisting a healthy masculinity, because your listener, bless her heart, who has been able to stay in touch with her feminine compassion, intuition, the gifts of the feminine, that is quite a feat. And she has a masculine within her. So it's not a question of finding something she doesn't have, but awakening and touching into it. So without the masculine energies, yes, and qualities, she won't be able to manifest and bring the feminine into the world the way she is capable of doing with all of its power. So we'll talk some about what that would look like, and hopefully I'll be able to give some suggestions on how she can connect to that masculine energy, which is within her, or pay attention to it. It's there somewhere, hidden.
Yeah.
You know, it's showing up in her dreams, or there are various ways that I'm sure her helpful animus, you know, the inner masculine that we all have, all of us women have, because yes, we need both. We need to integrate both. So it's a wonderful question.
I loved how she also used the phrase of awakening the masculine, because it does speak to this being a part of you. You know, it's not something you need to look
yes.
for.
No, exactly.
Yeah. So let's go ahead and start with the basics so that as we move forward, our listeners have a grasp of what we're talking about. Could you start, Marilyn, with talking about, you know, first of all, when we talk about masculine and feminine energies, or inner masculine or inner feminine, what are we talking about?
Well, in Jungian terms, we're talking about archetypes. So the archetypes of the masculine, the archetype of the feminine are within everybody. This means the energies, the imagery, conceptually, they are in everyone. But we are human beings living in a human time. So the energies are not equally distributed, because the feminine has been historically, in the last 5,000 years anyway, the qualities and energies of the feminine have been denigrated, denied, repressed. So they're not equally valued. So generally, most people have developed more of their masculine energy. So archetypally, I like to think of it in Jungian terms as the dynamic or static masculine and the dynamic or static feminine. And the dynamic masculine is the one that we're very familiar with. It's the heroic warrior, the one who strikes out for his goals, very ambitious, very aggressive. These are the warrior energies, very linear in focus. And the static masculine is like the king who sits and has the rules and the laws. In the feminine archetype, the static feminine is like the great mother. And we're very familiar with the great mother, who is all loving, all encompassing, all nurturing. And the dynamic feminine is the one that I mostly talk about, because that's the one we don't know. When we think of the feminine, we think of Eros. We think of connection, relationship, love, all wonderful qualities. But we don't think about the creative, transformative, playful, and fierce feminine. Now, the fierce feminine is more in the dynamic feminine realm. So all of these, this world of archetypes is available to us all, and we all develop it in individual ways. And then culturally, we also value one more than the other. So of course, it's been very much the masculine universally for 5,000 years, and in a particular American sense. We should maybe talk about current a bit.
And also later on, Marilyn, I want to bring in some dialogue about shadow, because I think that's also a huge factor in how these energies do or do not play out in a person's life, at least on a conscious level.
Oh, yes.
You know? Yeah.
I'm so glad you brought that up, Lourdes, and we should circle back to it if you want to leave it for the time being. But you and I were just talking before we started recording about the various constellations and energies in the planets and stars. And we've just had a new moon in Scorpio. Talk about shadow. Wow. So
right.
Scorpio is a very dark planet, but the gift is of death, rebirth, resurrection, transformation. But first, all the secrets have to come up. So I feel like what we're looking at, and if we're using the lens of masculine and feminine, we are looking at the secrets, the lies, the cheating, the betrayals, the really all sorts of horrors, the sexual assaults, the Harvey Weinstein. Now there's one after another, various CEOs, various congresspeople. These have been hidden in the shadow. So this is the shadow of masculinity, which is coming to the surface in order to be healed. So it's been going on certainly for this year, I would say. And this is so that we can really see and name what has been denied. So don't turn away from these. Look at them. But what can we do with them to redeem and transform them? So this is a very shadowy time, but it also has the potential for a great healing and new possibilities of the reunion of the masculine and the feminine, which is ultimately what we want as individuals and as a culture. Yeah, it's the sacred marriage. It's a balance of sacred masculine and sacred feminine. So, but on the way to doing that, first, we have to acknowledge the shadow and bring it up so that we can heal it. That means personally, but also culturally and planet-wise.
My next question was actually going to be about, you know, what are healthy and not so healthy expressions of masculine and feminine energies. And I believe that, you know, what you've just shared is really a excellent segue into that, because, you know, when with what we're seeing in current events with all of this stuff about sexual assault coming to the surface out of the dark.
Yep.
And, you know, what we're seeing here, like you said, it's this unhealthy or negative masculine coming to light. And then it is a different expression. I think we would call it what you said, the dynamic or fierce feminine that is now speaking about these things.
Exactly. Exactly right. When these stories, these events have surfaced before, there were certain factors that kept the feminine voice from being heard. One, she was isolated and didn't have collaboration. Two, she would not be believed. But three, I think also was that the static feminine was the one that has been most acceptable. When we as women are in relationship and we're caring about people and we're related and we understand them, the unhealthy version of that very beautiful gift of the feminine, the eros, the relationship, is we sacrifice our own well-being at times. We care so much out of our understanding, out of our compassion, that we end up betraying ourselves. So a healthier version of the feminine is indeed coming out of the same place. I think Scorpio holds secrets that are positive and negative, you know? It's just what's been hidden from view. And this fierceness that is coming out in the feminine voice says, no, you cannot devalue me that way. I no longer devalue myself. And I'm going to be assertive, even though that's been, you know, we've been indoctrinated out of our fierceness for such a long time. On the cellular level, we do remember the burning times, you know, the witches, the healers, the prophets, the priestesses who were burned at the stake for their powers. So this is a very difficult threshold to cross, to begin to use your voice on your own behalf, the courage to speak for other women. But because it's a collective story that is beginning to surface, you know, it's not just one woman. It's now we see the connection because it's coming up from the collective. That gives the shared power now. So it's both archetypal and it's individual. Yeah. And this is the fierce feminine. So that's exactly right. This is the archetype, the dynamic feminine that is gaining her health back. You know, she's gaining her power and her energy and her voice and her vision. So it's on all those levels, archetypal, collective, and individual.
You know, and in bringing in shadow into all of this, just as this negative shadow of masculine energy has just exploded to the surface, the feminine dynamic energy is also coming to the surface because it has been in shadow.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. So I think just showing how, you know, as you said earlier, that shadow doesn't contain, you know, just what we think of initially, which is all the stuff we don't want to look at, the painful stuff, the
right,
icky stuff,
right,
the ugly stuff.
Right.
It also contains our deepest, our strengths, untapped resources, potential, talents. And in this case, what struck out for me was that fierceness of fighting for one's sacredness and also speaking up and having that voice, because it seems to me that perhaps a way to maybe tease this out is when you're looking at feminine energy, it's coming out of the staticness and bringing it alive, bringing the movement into it, the dynamic.
Bringing the movement. Yeah. Exactly. I love how you said that. Yes.
Yeah.
It's bringing it to life in a moving way. Yes. Rather than just an encompassing and holding way, it's moving. You know, it's really.
Yeah.
And that's where the transformation, that's where the creativity. I don't know that I used that word when I was trying to give an overview of the dynamic feminine, but oh my gosh, your creativity is so expansive and so deep. So this is a very creative, moving time, very chaotic. Yeah, very chaotic. Mm-hmm.
Yes, very chaotic.
But yes, as you said about the shadow, that's so important. It is just what has been hidden from us. It's not all negative. And in terms of women and the feminine, I keep using this phrase this week as I'm trying to write about it. It's sifting the darkness for gold.
That's beautiful.
You like that?
I love that.
Good, good. Yeah. So I'll say it again then. Sifting the darkness for gold. And that is what I see women doing, really for all of us, for the collective. But we're going down there and we're bringing up these things that, oh, we didn't want to say, and we didn't want to tell, and we didn't want to talk about, and nobody, and saying it. And oh my gosh, it really is sifting the darkness for gold. And there is gold that is going to come for both the masculine and the feminine. This is so important that when we talk about the shadow aspects of masculinity, which is, oh my gosh, residing in the White House and many other places throughout the world. But that toxic masculinity is very, very harmful to men, to our male children and to men. You know, it really shrivels their souls and parches their spirit and takes them away from their heart. And that's one reason why men die 8 to 9 years earlier, and they have terrible suicide rates, especially over the age of 50, you know, because it's impossible to live like that and be a full human being. So this is a good thing that's happening, even though it's very painful and hard and chaotic. But out of the chaos, out of this turbulence and turmoil, this is where the new story is being born. It is being transformed. It's just very tough going, like any birth is, you know, messy,
yeah.
Very messy.
Very messy and painful. And yeah. And
very painful. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm just thinking how interesting it is because, you know, as I planned for this conversation, and I'm sure as you did too, you're really thinking about awakening the divine masculine or the inner masculine. And really,
yes.
You can't have this conversation without also looking at shadow and the feminine principle.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
So could you give some maybe like everyday examples of how this could show up as far as now stepping back from collective and what's happening on the mm-hmm. world stage, but now into the individual lives of how, what does it look like when a woman does not have access to her inner masculine?
Okay, yes, I'll turn that around because I started going down the road of what is a familiar story. So I'll just take you down that turn in the road, and then we'll come back to the feminine. But because what comes to mind is so many of the women that I've seen professionally, also colleagues, but mostly professionally, have been women who, in order to bring their gifts and power to try and express themselves in society, adopted very masculine ways of thinking and feeling. You never cry at the office. You always have the answer. And cut off a lot of their tenderness in order to succeed in the culture. This includes not just the business world, but in medicine. You know, becoming a doctor. What does that require you to do? It's a very masculine, driven, competitive field where that you don't get to use your intuition very much, or your heart tenderness, you know, feminine gifts. So that's what first came to mind. But when a woman, let's talk about your, because we were talking about what sparked this second conversation, which I'm so grateful for, Lourdes, is the woman who is very in touch with her gifts of compassion and caring and intuition, even, but she feels too unable to bring those into the world because she doesn't have any masculine fire behind it, any masculine muscle behind it, and she doesn't know how to get in touch with that inner masculine. So when that happens, you generally, the women who are like that are very big-hearted, caring women, but it's hard to take care of yourself if you don't have any of that fierceness, which we talked about in the feminine, but it's also kind of a masculine setting of boundaries and being knowing how to be linear. And it's like there is a time for being a competitive kind of fierce, like an athlete is, you know. So one of the ways that I think I developed, and so this is anecdotal, but I think it helps so many women who have been in sports. So if you are in your body and you learn the strength of your body, and you can do this through swimming or yoga or running, you begin to get in touch with the fire and the strength that is within you, which is masculine in a way, but it's in a feminine body, you know, so it's like an embodiment of that masculine power. And another way that I have counted on my whole life, and so do the people I see, is finding, because we were talking about the masculine is always within you. So for that woman, he is there, that helpful animus. It might be a critical animus, but there's a masculine energy that is there that might be showing up in her dreams. If she has dreams, look for the male figures in her dreams. Are they friendly? Are they threatening? Are they critical? And many women, and this comes back to the idea of a toxic masculinity, because we have it within us, you know. Many women have to get over the threshold. I'll say, I don't know about most, but yes, I'm going to say most. I am going to say most, because most women have experienced masculine power as not beneficent, you know, as threatening or critical or controlling. This doesn't mean necessarily that you had an abusive father or those kinds of really terrifying and terrible experiences as a child, but culturally, for so many thousands of years, who you are as a woman, your innate gifts and talents were disparaged and not valued. So the masculine that we internalize is not a friendly one and not a helpful one. Threatening, power over, dominating, or just plain critical all the time. So when you think about stepping out into the world or taking a dream of yours, having some ambition, as your writer queried, you have to encounter that power. It's like, oh, I don't want to be powerful like that. I don't want to be the kind of person who is always competing and trying to have power over and control people and be critical and mean and take everything for themselves. That's not anything I want in my life. And of course it isn't, but that's the way masculine power has shown up for such a long time historically. But that isn't a healthy masculine power. That's a twisting of what healthy masculine power, and I would say, is the power to protect, and it's the power to restore, and it's the power to hold space. And all of those things are needed to support the feminine. So it's kind of if we look at it in nature terms, it's solid ground. It's the solid ground for the more flowing energies of the feminine. A healthy masculine holds space, protects space, contains that space for the feminine to flourish. So it's like the solid earth ground for a flowing river. So that is healthy. It is not the kind of power that we want to develop as human beings, but as women, is not the kind of power that we've seen. That doesn't mean you can't be powerful. You just have to write a new story and express it in a feminine power way, which is the more restorative, creative, transformative kind of power that joins and connects us to each other, us to the earth, us to the creatures of the earth. It doesn't kill them. You know, should I mention trophy hunting? That's just a horrible one. That hunter who kills the elephant, that is not a healthy masculine power. That is the sign of an insecure, toxic masculine power. So no, of course we don't want to be like that. And I'm just trying to say, no, you don't have to be like that to be a powerful woman. Absolutely not. That is not true power.
I think, like, for, you know, just to try to think of some situations that perhaps the average woman who's struggling with awakening her inner masculine might face could be something, you know, let's say you have an idea or a dream or a goal. Mm-hmm. I think that sitting with that, incubating that, wondering about it, dreaming, reflecting, that's all the feminine.
Yes.
And then the masculine is when you decide to enroll in a class.
Right.
Or you decide to invest in therapy or coaching or something that will help you get to another point with your with your dream or your goal. And what I, where I see women getting stuck is doubting themselves about whether this is really what they want and whether this is really a good idea. And then the next part is,
yeah,
they don't know this always on a conscious level, but this fear that, that others will perceive this as a bad idea or will change, this will affect the relationship because of a decision that they're pursuing.
Yes.
And then I think women also, more than men, can get stuck in that sense of they don't want to fail. And so I think for the masculine energy comes in where you go ahead and make a choice and follow through full well knowing that you could be wrong, you could fail, and others may judge you. And
yeah.
Right. Yeah. And you do it anyway. You do it anyway. You move forward.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for bringing that to the personal level. That's so important. And yes, we women, when we have these wonderful ideas, many things happen. Because of course we have dreams and ambitions. That's just part of our human divinity. You know, that we came to earth with that. Women, they have found, and I don't have the statistics in front of me, but most women think that they have to be more knowledgeable, know what they're doing all the time, and be perfect before they can step out.
Right. Yes.
Men are kind of on the opposite end of the entitlement. Knowing nothing.
Yeah.
Knowing nothing. They feel completely free to step forward and say, I can do that. I know how to do that. Oh my gosh. So trying to move us off the spectrum of one, thinking that we need to be perfect in order to step forward. And two, that you started to touch on this, and I think we should really call it by its name, which is we are taught from a very young age that it is dangerous. It is dangerous to want something for yourself.
Yes.
To want to be powerful and to follow your dreams. There are various ways we women hear that, are told that. It's you're being selfish, which is a horrible thing. As if that's a horrible thing to take care of yourself. But still, being selfish is a mean and uncaring, which means you're not caring for other people. You're not caring for your partner. You're not caring for your children. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to be doing that to a degree of self-sacrifice, which is really quite injurious. But you're supposed to do that. You're not supposed to want something for yourself that's selfish. And then the underlying threat of all of that is, if you do this, if you step forward and say, I want this, I really want this, and I'm capable of doing it, no one will love you.
Yeah.
No one will love you because you're not being feminine. Did you ever hear that in your life? You're a different generation than I, but I certainly heard that in my family. You will be all alone.
Yeah, I didn't hear that, but I definitely felt and intuited responses to me putting myself first or
right, not supposed to do it, right?
Or even this is kind of, I think this is a good example. If a man said, I want to become a CEO and make a lot of money, mm-hmm. nobody would think anything of that.
They admire him.
Right.
Good for you. Go get him.
Now, let's say there's a woman and she says, I want to be a CEO and make a lot of money. Then people will say, well, what about your kids? You know, and, you know, are you being materialistic? Mm-hmm. and you can even get this from other women because they don't even realize it. Yeah,
it's the worst because it hurts.
Yeah,
it hurts the most because we need help from other women, from our sisters. But yes, exactly, from other women who are also fighting their own impulses. Yeah, to follow something that is a dream of theirs. But being accused of being a cold-hearted, we won't use bad language on this podcast. If you want that, if you were a woman and said, you know what I want to do? I want to be a CEO, have my own company, and make a lot of money. It's like, oh, she must be a really cold-hearted, you know? Right.
You know, in fact, this is so interesting because I was speaking with another guest. We were talking about the choice that many women make to be child-free.
Yeah.
And even the, you know, is the same thing that we're talking about, that if you're not going to be a mother to a child, if you choose that,
yeah,
it's almost like, you're not really a woman. What's wrong with you? If that's some
exactly,
and I think that again is part of that expectation of this is what it means to be feminine, is to carry a baby in your body and give birth and nurture that life
and take care of others. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yeah.
Very basic, and just to even out the. So you're not even a woman. So it's like your very basic being is being questioned when you act like this. And conversely, for a man, let's say a man wants to take off 2 years and stay home with his new baby.
Yeah.
He is vulnerable, both on an inner basis, but outside, and he will be punished for that, you know, that he's not a real man. So we are, both genders suffer from these terrible prescriptions that don't allow us to be fully human. And, you know, I heard an interesting, well, I wanted to say one more thing about women stepping out and using their voices. And this has been chronicled over and over again, that the women who are within most institutions of learning or business or good, who have great ideas and they're in a board meeting and they raise their hands and they're ignored. And 2 minutes later, I mean, it's almost a joke, right? And then 2 minutes later, a man says the exact same thing, brings up the point. Oh my God, that's brilliant.
You know? Yeah,
that can get very discouraging. There's kind of, which is why most the women who leave corporate, it's not leaving to be mommies or what, it's leaving because they don't have room for their creativity, you know, to be honored. But even if you're and being a mommy, yes, part of it is internal, how are you going to succeed? But it's also like structurally, it's hard at certain levels of business, certainly, and medicine, to have children, raise children, because there's so little flexibility in the structures. It's as if it's not a valuable thing to do with your time and energy, you know? So,
yeah.
So I heard the other day, I don't know if you listened to NPR, but there was an interview with, her name is Sarah Lacey, and she has her own business. She's a journalist, and it's an investigative journalism company called Pando, I think. And she was talking about she's a single mom, she has two kids, talking about various struggles in her career's journey to becoming a business owner of her own. And all of these kinds of stories that would come at her. What kind of a woman are you? You know, and you can't work like that. You can't possibly have your own company and be a good mom. And be a good mom. And she said, there's, in fact, being a mother has helped her be a better businesswoman for various logistical things. You know, you have to be very efficient. But she said the capacities that it developed in her. So her feminine qualities are exactly what is making her business so successful. She works hard. She has the masculine. She had the drive and the ambition. She's a very fierce and funny woman. So listen to Terry Gross and hear about that. But the disparagement or the splitting of, you can be a good woman and a good mother, or you can be a successful professional in the world. We are all struggling with that, you know, women and men. Yeah.
So I think that that comes from seeing these feminine and masculine principles as opposites and
right,
seeing them on two ends of the spectrum. And also, I think, you know, when we begin to associate these energies with gender, which a lot of people do. Yeah.
Right. Yes. Most people do, I think, Lourdes.
Yeah. So when you think about what can happen when a woman begins to over-identify with her feminine energy, what can this start to look like? Where it becomes more of an, she's really stuck on that end of the polarity and not really living out the masculine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that looks like a lot of depression a lot of times, because all of this energy is buried back to the shadow. A lot of self-sacrifice. Yeah, giving so much to your partner, children, friends. So yes, we value relationship and caring, but when you do it to this, excluding any masculine energy, but also excluding that dynamic feminine, you know, which is the fierce one, when you are only a caring, giving person, you are going to run out of psychic, spiritual, emotional, physical energy at some point.
Yeah.
You know, there's an awful lot of suffering and illness, imbalance in your any of your relationships.
Yeah.
You know, ultimately.
And you can see how that's going to, you know, lead to resentment. And
yeah,
even in your own relationships, it may be unconscious, but there is going to be that beneath the surface. And I think it's interesting, you know, just connecting this with what you were saying earlier, Marilyn, about how, you know, women, we're rewarded and valued for being nice girls, for giving, for taking care of other people, for being soft-spoken.
Mm-hmm.
And then also, you know, for being sexy, for having a nice body, for youth. Okay. And so all those things, right? Yes.
Yeah.
And so you can see how these things that society, our families, our cultures all say, this is what is lovable. This is what will get you approval. This is what will get you inclusion. It makes sense that you will do all of that.
Yes.
Right?
Absolutely. That's the price of belonging. And as you say, being lovable. What's more important than that, than knowing that you are loved? So it's a pretty big price that we have over our heads to continue being nice, always patient, always giving, yes, and thin and sexy.
And cooking and cleaning, right? All of it.
And cooking. Yes. Right.
Yeah. Yes.
But yes, unconsciously, you know, deep within, there is a fire in us that's like, oh no, it's going to bite back. So what are you going to do to quell that voice that keeps saying, wait a minute, what about me? So yes, there's resentment, there's bitterness, or we go to ways to silence that voice, which are not good for us. We go to drinking. We go to shopping. We go to anything that will quiet that voice that will not give up. I mean, it does not go away. It doesn't go away.
And I know that this, you know, this may sound dramatic, but I feel, you know, when I'm sitting with women who are in this position, and they're really grappling with this, oh wow, putting myself first and trying to just work with that. And then, well, what would this mean for everyone around me? And there's a degree of, selfishness or selflessness where you have to put yourself first. And I tell them, you're probably going to have to, I don't know if this is the best word, but you're going to have to fight for this. You're going to have to scratch your way out for this, because no one's going to just say, oh, this is important to you. You need to do this. You need more time. You need us to make these changes so you can pursue what you want. It's almost like we're that fierceness, that warrior energy of, you need to strike out for yourself. You need to go for what you want. You need to just realize that people will have strong feelings about this. And this is part of the process, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, that's beautifully put. And it made me laugh because, no, your children, your partner, your friends, the friends who counted on you for the rides to the airport or the extra, you know,
right.
They're not going to say, oh, that's great.
Right.
Go ahead, go for it, because we really want you to be happy and fulfilled. No. You're going to be disappointing people. They want you to stay in that position. Right. That works for them.
Yeah.
Do all the meals, do all the laundry. I mean, who wants to do all that stuff all the time?
Yeah.
So, yeah, you do have to kind of develop a, the image of a rhino came to mind when you were talking, Lord. So you need to develop a bit of a thick skin.
Yeah.
Knowing that, ultimately, your survival,
mm-hmm.
you know, the survival of really the intrinsic soul of you is at stake. And ultimately, if that's not around, if you're not around in that way, you really can't be very present, loving, caring of the people in your life. But let's not think about them right now. Just that you do have to fight and scrabble, and you have to overcome the voices without, of course, which want you to stay in the same place where you've been, always giving, sacrificing, caring. And the voices within, which are probably going to be telling you this is not only hurting other people, but it's bad and dangerous and will make you unlovable and you'll be alone and no one will ever love you, etc. Those are lies. Those are not true voices. And another thing I think that will help women, well, the support of others, to know that you're not alone, that there are other women, your therapist, that helps so much to have a voice, right? Taken seriously and who really understands the importance of this, because this is your soul speaking for your life. It's like,
yeah,
I need you to do this. So that too, I think helps to give it a bit of a bigger picture, which is to know that you came. Why did you come to Earth? Why are you here? You know, what are you meant to do? And we all have that spark of the divine within us. And when you start paying attention to that, whether you're an introvert or an extrovert, you know, when you start looking for the divinity in yourself, you acknowledge that you are a divine being as well as a human being, a person of matter. It's like, well, that kind of helps to blow. It's like, I think I'm meant to do this. I think I came here for a reason.
Yeah.
Or two. You know, I think I have something to offer and to give to this world. And that comes from God, cosmos, the universe, the great mystery, you know? And that kind of is a bigger reason than the fact that my best friend is annoyed because I don't have as much time for her.
Yeah.
On the phone anymore, because I have to get this essay published, or I have to, you know, make these calls.
Yeah.
So I think that helps to kind of bolster you in fighting for your right to be wholly and fully as yourself.
Yeah. And I think this is a beautiful way to kind of bring it back to where we began, which is, again, that fierceness, you know?
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have, I kind of look at it in the sense that many women, in many ways, repeatedly lay down their lives for others.
Yes.
You know, and so when you feel like you're dying or you feel like you don't know who you are anymore, you wonder, you know, what have I been doing? That makes sense because you have put your life aside and have been helping others to live theirs. And so,
yes.
Again, and not to sound dramatic or extreme, but I really feel that when a woman is at this point, and frequently they are depressed or anxious,
mm-hmm.
there is a sense of urgency, a sense of
yes.
this is an emergency, like
yes.
almost like you need to put the mask on yourself so you can breathe.
Yes, it is.
And so you do have to, again, bring in that warrior energy of fighting for yourself, putting yourself first.
Yes.
And when you do this, it's uncomfortable and people won't like it.
That's right. So. That is true. But the other thing, and this is so important that you just brought up this word emergency, and it isn't too dramatic at all because, and I'm sure you know women in your life, both personally and professionally, who, if you ignore this voice of the soul for too long, something is going to happen in your life that is a real emergency. I have heard, I'll give you a kind of medium mild one, of a woman who was successful but unhappily employed in corporate. She had a pretty high executive position, but she had not been happy for a long time, but she was breadwinner to her family. It was hard to turn down all that money and healthcare and all of that, but she was increasingly unhappy, and she started to develop full-blown multiple sclerosis, which made her tend to herself. Yeah, so she had to tend to the physical part, but she became unable to do her job. So it seemed kind of like a tragedy at the time, because she had to ultimately leave. It was too stressful a job. So to save her health and save her life, she did have to resign her position. And it took a while and it was tough, but she started telling the truth about what she really wanted to do and what she was drawn to do. And fast forward a couple of years, and she went back to school. She hadn't been since college. She went back to school and got a degree as a therapist in consciousness studies, you know, transpersonal psychology. And guess what? She doesn't have MS anymore.
Wow, that's powerful.
It has receded. And I said, how long has it been? She said, I haven't had any symptoms for 3 years. So
wow,
it just came on, you know? And it gives me goose pimples, really, to recall this story for you. It was the way her soul could speak to her. The soul does speak through the body.
Yeah.
I mean, it speaks in many ways. Yeah. It speaks through dreams and it speaks through synchronicities and certain people appearing. But it really, it lives. Our body is within the soul. It's not the soul within the body. The body is within the soul, which is larger than that. So think of it as a field of energy. And when it really, really, really needs to get your attention, it does it through the body. So if you do not pay attention to the urgency of these calls of a soul calling, you know, you're to sing your soul song, we've talked about before, but if you ignore the calls of your soul and to sing your song for too long, something like that is likely to happen, because your soul doesn't give up on you ever.
Yeah.
But if you're ignoring it, it has its own fierceness. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, to save your fire, I'm going to have to put you through this.
Yeah.
And there's some very tragic ones. I mean, this one, you know, she was able to turn it around. It doesn't always happen like that. Sometimes you have to suffer a great loss that is not
right
recoverable. Yeah. To get you on the right trail. But it is happening for your spiritual health and for the fulfillment of what you're meant to be doing, you know, to sing your soul song. But anyway, it's better if you can listen before something like that happens, the great illness, the great catastrophe. But sometimes, I mean, do you remember the great fire long ago in Oakland, you know, the one in 1990, whatever it was?
Yeah.
A very nice neighborhood man who owned the dry cleaning business that I'd always gone to, and his father had owned it before him. He lost everything. They just got out, he and his family, his wife and kids, got out of their house just with what they had on their backs. So they lost everything, burned to the ground. And I was talking to him about it. This was a few months later. And I said, oh my God, I'm so sorry. You know, what a terrible, terrible thing. I mean, I'm glad you survived, but really you lost everything. And he just broke into this smile. And he said, you know what? He said, it was the best thing that ever happened to me. He said, because I could not leave this business. It was a family business. My family was dependent, but I had always wanted to sail around the world, but we were just too encumbered with the mortgage. And he said, well, now we're not, we don't have anything. So he said, and they were taking off and they were leaving. He had sold the business. He and his wife, the kids were older, so they were, you know, off in college, they were on their own. We're going to take off around the world. It was something he had always wanted to do his entire life, but he never could give himself the freedom, you know, to do that. So we've come back to the masculine, but it's the same thing, you know, that constricts us. Because the fierce feminine is the creative and playful and really a joyful spirit. And it's hard to trust her and listen to her. But oh my gosh, that gives you back your life.
Yeah.
You know.
So Marilyn, for our dear listener who inspired this episode and who wrote in.
Oh, thank you. Yes.
Do you have any words of wisdom for her as we wrap up?
Yeah, I would like to go back to talking about the physicality of knowing her own strength, that will help her a lot because the body is important. She needs to know how strong she is. She doesn't know how strong she is, but I'm sure she is. So any kind of physical activity that she enjoys that can help her develop her stamina and strength, that will help her get in touch with it. I would say pay attention to your dreams, to any men that show up in your life, in your dream life or outside, because what we're looking for is a helpful animus, the one who's supporting her and wants the best for her. And I would also join with other women who, I don't know if she said in that letter, I can't recall that she did, that she had any particular dream or thing that she'd always wanted to do. But
yeah, she didn't.
I didn't hear. Okay. So I would use that intuition, which she has, and try and follow it. See, what are you interested in? What would you like to do? Because just as you were speaking, Lourdes, at the beginning of the hour, that the masculine, taking that masculine muscle and moving in the direction means maybe going back to school, taking a course, getting a certification. And if she doesn't know yet what she might like to do, start trying things. I think I might like to take a drawing class. Let your masculine get you there, sign you up, remember what time the class is, you know, or get a certification and start exploring. Just with taking action, because the masculine, particularly the dynamic masculine, you know, takes action. So just start moving. Just start moving. And then you check back with your feminine. Did I like that? How did I feel about that? Is that something I want to pursue? You know, so you start to develop a relationship. But yeah, get into movement and get into action and find your strength and look for those male figures in your dreams and see, because they're trying to get your attention, I imagine.
Thank you so much, Marilyn. This conversation was just delightful, inspiring, and just so important to have. So thank you for spending this time with me today.
Thank you, Lourdes, so much for the opportunity. I really enjoyed talking with you.
And before we go, this is really important. Can you share with our listeners the best way to get in touch with you and learn more about your work?
Yes. My website, Lourdes, is www.thewildfeminine.com. So there's more about me and my work there and a free gift page for you, which you can log into, the Way of the Wild Feminine Gifts. That's a separate page, or you can write me directly and I'd be delighted to hear from you. Any questions or comments or anything that's just sparked in you, because it's such an important conversation to keep having at this time. And my email address is Dr. M. Steele. So that's Dr. M as in Marilyn Steele, Steele, @gmail.com. And I would be delighted to hear from you.
And we will make sure to include all of those links in our show notes. Thank you again, Marilyn. This was an absolute joy.
Thank you. It was a joy for me too, Lourdes. All the best.
Take care.
Bye.
Bye. Thanks so much for listening to the Women in Depth podcast. I hope it brings you a deeper understanding of yourself and others, and that you found some insights that illuminated and inspired. You can follow Women in Depth on Facebook and YouTube, and if you haven't yet, please subscribe on iTunes and leave a review. And finally, if you enjoy Women in Depth, please share with a friend. Again, thank you so much for listening, and see you next time.